IVM.
On this episode of Paisa Vaisa, my three-part series on taxation of mutual funds continues. And in this episode, we're going to talk about how you can save tax on mutual funds. My guests are Harsh Mulchandani and Nikhil Chowdhary, who work at a Big Four accounting firm.
Hey, it's been another great week on IVM Podcast. If you're not following us on social media, please, please, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Our Instagram page is actually pretty interesting. The stories we do are the team and what they're doing on a day-to-day basis. And, you know, they're pretty kind of fun. Take a look at them. Let us know what you think. This week on Cyrus Says, Cyrus's guest is writer and journalist Namita Devi Dayal. She talks about how she got into journalism, her background in Indian classical music, and her upcoming book titled The Sixth String of Vilayat Khan. On The Seen and the Unseen, Amit Verma's guest is a cricket commentator and journalist whose voice most cricket fans can identify. I hope you guessed that is Harsha Bhogle. He spoke to Amit about the evolution of Indian cricket, its rise, and the changes that he has witnessed over the years. Really, really great episode, and we're really excited to have Harsha on the network. Please definitely check it out. We also launched a brand new show called The Paperback Podcast, hosted by Racheta Sharma and Satyajit Roy. Every week, they'll talk to industry experts about five of their favorite nonfiction books. The first episode featuring Apurva Damani of Artha Ventures is out on the 5th. On the Rediscovery Podcast final episode of this season, Ambika and Hosha talk to Pankil Shah and Sumit Gambhir. They talk food, travel, and the secret ingredients to a decade of managing Indian restaurants. Pankil and Sumit were also participants in our other show, The Kolaba Cartel, so it'll definitely be a fun conversation and definitely check them out. And with that, let's move on with the shows.
Folks, welcome to Paisa Vaisa. I'm your host, Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter. And this is the second of our three-part series on taxation of mutual funds. My guests are Harsh Mulchandani and Nikhil Chowdhary, who work for a Big Four accounting firm. In the first of the three-part series, we spoke about basics, income tax basics, and how long-term capital gains, short-term capital gains impact your investments in a debt mutual fund, in an equity mutual fund, SIPs, and a lot of that. Bit technical, but you really need to know all of that. This second part, we are going to talk about how to save tax by investing in mutual funds. Now, as per the Income Tax Act, there are various provisions which say that you invest in certain things, could be a home loan, could be medical insurance, life insurance, all of that. You are allowed certain concessions from your income. One of these provisions, one of these benefits is in something called an ELSS, which stands for an Equity Linked Savings Scheme. So this part is going to explain to you how do you use that benefit to save on tax in your annual income. Harsh, Nikhil, welcome back to the show. Let's get right into this. What exactly is an ELSS and what are the benefits that you get?
So, ELSS is a separate breed in the equity-oriented scheme only. Hmm. But it comes with a catch wherein there is a mandatory lock-in of 3 years.
So, that means that once I apply for an ELSS, I have to stay invested in that for minimum of 3 years.
Yeah.
Okay. So that means that, you know, let's say it's February, March and my HR is after me ki batao kitna tumne tax investment kiya hai, because they need to calculate my take home salary for the month of March, and I'm running around and I find you guys and I say, please help me. So you'll come and tell me that, listen, here is something that you can invest in that will save on your tax. It's called an ELSS, Equity Linked Savings Scheme, and whatever amount I put in it,
Basically, since it is subject to 3-year lock-in, income tax actually protects you, which gives you the ATC benefit.
Okay.
Wherein the amount that you invest subject to maximum of 1,50,000 would be reduced from your total income.
Okay. So that means that Section 80C, of course, is a huge thing. It
huge
has got
thing.
10, 20 different things where I can put my money and I'll get the tax. We're just talking about one tiny part of
tiny
that.
Part
okay,
of
because
it.
If you're a salaried income guy, you would know that a certain part of your provident fund already goes towards that. Okay, the income tax says that 1,50,000 is the maximum benefit that you get. It's very likely that out of that 1,50,000, you've already exhausted some of your limit for your provident fund, or probably for some premium or for some home loan or for something or the other. Okay. There'll be some amount left. Okay. I remember when I was working, there was always some amount left where I would sit in and wonder, isko kahan dalo? Okay. I need that 1,50,000. And that's where an ELSS comes in, right?
Yes.
Okay. So then what happens?
So here, the sale of units that you make would again be subject to capital gains, and the taxation would be completely same as we discussed in part one.
Okay, so but the trick is that once on, say, Feb, March, whenever, once I find an ELSS, okay, that's again a different thing. Let's say that in XYZ mutual fund, I you know, I find an ELSS and let's say that I invest 50,000 in it, that 50,000 is gone for 3 years. So each and every year I should ideally, because equity is a great way to save money, I should use that provision given to me by the Income Tax Act and keep on putting in some money or the other. The only trick is it's locked in for 3 years, which means that I cannot sell this for 3 years. Okay. Let's say that we're in 2018 and in 2021, my 3 years is over. What happens then?
So, it is not necessary that you need to sell those units.
Let's assume that I have a requirement to sell it. I actually say that my 3 years are over, boss, give me the money back.
Correct.
Okay? And I've actually made a gain.
So, here, the gains that you made is exempt up to 1 lakh rupees.
Hmm.
And the gains above 1 lakh would be subject to tax at the rate of 10%.
Okay.
Also, the thing that I would like to point over here is every investment that you make, the benefit that you get under ATC, there would be a slab rate wise benefit that would be given. For example, you are falling in the 5% slab, 10% slab or the 30% slab. The benefit would be the slab that you are falling in.
Okay.
So for example, if you have invested 1 lakh rupees and you are falling in the 5% slab, the tax benefit that you get is 5,000 rupees.
Okay. You want to say something on that, Arsh? You're saying?
That is the main catch. So people generally assume that if I'm investing say 50,000, I'll get a straightforward 50,000 benefit.
Of course I will, right?
No.
Oh,
that
seriously?
Is what he just said. Slab rate benefit. So if you are investing 50,000,
uh-huh,
you fall in 5% slab rate, the only tax you will be saving is 2,500.
I don't get the entire 50,000.
You get slab rate benefit.
Okay, folks. So just, see, that's the advantage of having budding chartered accountants on the show. The entire 50,000 will not be excluded from your income. Okay?
50,000 would be excluded from income,
huh,
but income is taxed as per slab. So you will effectively get the slab. In monetary terms, you will get 2,500 of tax benefit.
Okay.
So if you're falling in the 5 to 10 lakh range, the benefit would be 20% on that.
Okay. Okay, fine. Now, we just want to talk about how you can use loss harvesting in LTC. So folks, loss harvesting as a concept in stocks is very well known. You know, you have a bonus or you have a split, the share value falls and you buy before and you sell after, you can actually carry for that entire loss, stuff like that. That's a little bit technical, but again, those are stocks. We're not talking stocks, we're talking mutual funds. Harsh is going to tell us how, to some extent, this even applies to mutual funds. Harsh, tell us.
Yes, so we have loss harvesting and I'm going to coin a new term also, gain harvesting.
Okay.
So I'll just start with the gain harvesting first because you might be hearing it for the first time. So the thing is, you get 1 lakh, above 1 lakh, your equity gains get taxable. So what if you have made, say, a gain of 80 to 90,000 in 1 year and it's already long term? You can actually sell it off, take that gain of 80-90,000 rupees as tax free, and then again next day invest it back and again hold it on for a longer term. So what this will essentially help you is save on to your tax to the tune of the gain you've already made.
Hmm.
But mind you, you have to be very careful that all your units which you are selling on a particular date have crossed 12 months, and you cannot do that for ELSS because for ELSS the lock-in is 3 years.
Yeah.
So after 3 years, maybe you can try it and say, for example, you can take help of someone who can just do help this for you. And again, mind you, how much tax you'll be saving by putting in so much effort would be 10% of the gain. So for example, if you made a gain of 80,000, someone tells you that 1 lakh gain is exempt, you just book your gains and then again invest it in some other equity mutual fund or the same mutual fund, you'll be saving 10% of 80,000, which is 8,000.
Mm.
So that is for gain harvesting. Now, for loss harvesting, it is like you book your loss. Over a period of time, you've been holding a mutual fund and you book that loss, and then you can use that long-term capital loss to set off against any other long-term capital gain which you have. For example, you've sold a house, you have a long-term capital gain, you can use this long-term capital loss from mutual funds to set off the gains you've made from selling your house, which might be a long-term capital gain.
Okay. We're going to just take a concrete example of that. Okay, guys, this year the Nifty is down some 15%, and let's say that over the last 3-4 years you've actually made a loss, and Harsh specified that it has to be a long-term capital loss, which means that you should have been holding your mutual fund for at least 1 year. Okay, let's say that you've been holding a certain mutual fund which over the last 3 years or over the last 5 years has actually not done well. So you invested say 1 lakh and that 1 lakh has actually fallen to maybe 50,000. Okay, it's halved in value. You're really, really sad. But guess what? You can actually put that 50,000 into your income tax return and say, this is my loss carried forward. Okay, how is it useful? Let's say that you actually sell a house, like what Harsh said, and there you've made a nice big fat capital gain. A gain long term. 5 years ago, you bought a house. 5 years later, you're selling a house. And let's say the capital gains on that is 80,000. Okay. So your 80,000 long term capital gain will now stand reduced by 50,000, which is your long term capital loss on the mutual fund. So your actual capital gain on your income tax return will be 30,000. Harsh, am I right in that?
Yes, yes.
Okay. And how many years can I carry forward
this? You can carry forward for 8 years from the end of the financial year.
Okay. So would you think it makes some kind of sense, you know, for someone to just kind of plan ki mera koi to aisa useless scheme hai jahan mera loss ban raha hai, long term capital gain loss.
Yes. So, even if it is short term, you can book short term and set it off against long term. But you cannot set off a long term capital gains against a short term capital gain.
So that's saying that basically a short term capital loss can be only offset against a long term capital gain.
Then short term can be set off against long term as well as short as well as long, and for a long term is
always
long term.
Okay, you want to just repeat that very simply.
So just to repeat, you can have a short term gain as well, and you can you do tax harvesting for short term losses as well. The thing is, if you have a short term loss, you can set it off against a long term gain. As well as a short-term gain.
Okay.
Whereas for a long-term loss, you have to set it off with long-term gain only.
Okay. I hope that is simple enough for you guys. But then that's tax. Bound to be some complications. Like I've always said, you can reach out to these guys. You can reach out to Harsh on Twitter, Nikhil on LinkedIn. And that is a wrap on the second part of our three-part series on taxation or mutual funds. Stay tuned for the third part, which is going to be fun because it's going to talk about how to avoid common mistakes in taxation. Stay tuned for that.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
Yeah. It's IVM here. Let's go. We the IVM kids on the block over here. Just to talk, taking a break from producing all day. Coming on this podcast because we got stuff to say. IVM Daily is the name of the show. Monday to Friday, we ready to go. Talking about stuff in our head. We might even talk about our favorite bread. Signing out, it's IVM here, the podcast network that's in your ear.
Catch IVM Daily, Monday to Friday, on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Long, long ago, not in Bethlehem, but in a place nearby, there was a wonderful birth of a huge show, which I like to call Cyrus Says. A show that encapsulates everything in human history, from the first Homo sapien to the last Homo sapien, who's traversed the entire world and then come back to India. This is a show which tells you everything about everything. If you want to know, avoid Google, come to us. It's called Cyrus Says. Get new episodes every Monday and Thursday on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you get your podcasts from. It's simple as A, B, oh God, what comes after that?